意大利、西班牙、德国、法国。2020年春天，新冠疫情在欧洲爆发，不少网友感慨，一旦发达入欧洲，竟也遭病魔肆虐。同时，也认识到欧洲的防疫思路与中国并不相同。那么，作为世界一体化程度最高的区域组织，欧盟在抗疫中做了哪些工作？与中美有哪些合作？对于病毒来源和封城措施的争议，又是何种态度？2020年是中欧合作大年，疫情下，中欧峰会磋商是否还在进行？在后疫情时代，又该如何展开合作？我们带着这些问题对话欧盟驻华大使尼古拉斯·玉白。
We know that in January and February, EU has donated maybe 56 tons of PPE, personal protective equipment, to China, which is very helpful. And so could you give us some details on how it begins?
Well, yes, as immediately end of January, after the decision to put Roubaix in lockdown, the president of the European Commission talked to your prime minister over the phone and immediately said, if you need any help, just ask us. We are ready to assist. And we did that immediately, early February, first week of February, when we sent our first planes.To extract Europeans from Roubaix, who wanted to go home. There were many European planes, French, German, British at the time, because Brexit had not yet happened. So, and we used these planes to bring medical equipment to Roubaix. So we sent effectively from more than 10 European countries,a total of 56 tons of medical equipment to China. And I think we were the first to do that, if I recall well. But we are not in a competition. It was just an expression of solidarity. And we didn't make a fuss about it. We just did it. And I think it was very much appreciated in Wuhan, because maybe you don't know that, but Wuhan,is one of the cities in China, with Shanghai and Beijing, was the most important level of medical cooperation with Europe. There's a German hospital in Wuhan. There's a French hospital in Wuhan. So we have lots of know-how and relationships and so on. So it was easy to organize. And we did that immediately. And after that,There came the moment when the China National Health Commission was ready to share its experiences with Europeans. Now that was before the outbreak in Europe. We didn't wait. You know, people say today China has sacrificed itself and the world has not acted. Well, in Europe it's not true. We have acted beginning of January, end of January, beginning of February.Immediately by talking to your National Health Commission. And there have been already three conferences between the Health Commission and the European Union Health Directorate. So that was extremely helpful and we will continue to do that. Already maybe 10 days ago, the President of the European Commission talked again with Premier Li Keqiang,and your Minister of Commerce, Zhongshan, called later on with our people to organize a fast-track procurement avenue with high-quality medical equipment. People say, with sometimes ill intention, this is the end of globalization. Or they say, decoupling. Everybody...is in his bubble. We say no, on the contrary. This crisis shows that we need more solidarity, more global cooperation than ever before. Now everybody knows that if you go alone, you're going to lose more lives. If you go together, you save lives. So on public health,We have now organized ourselves to bring support to in equipment. We also have made major financial contributions for research into a vaccine globally, not only EU, but globally, and there are four Chinese laboratories that are now working within that framework, the global framework of research to develop a vaccine. Because we know now that without a vaccine, the situation we know today in the world will continue. And there will be no quick fix until we have a vaccine. So the first priority is to develop a vaccine. For instance, we are seeing in Europe the aggressive rate of a virus is stronger than in China. Why is that? Because it has spread to a larger population. It has adapted to the human body.
As we know, the Spain and Italy as the epicenter of Europe. So did EU have some concrete support to these countries?
Of course. Today, the most affected countries in Europe are Italy, Spain, and France. Okay? In terms of number of cases, confirmed cases, and deaths. And immediately, when Italy declared its confinement and lockdown measures, the European Union stepped in immediately. And I was sorry to see in China a lot of fake stories around. The help from the Union was immediate and massive. France and Germany has given millions of masks to Italy, continue on a daily basis, but not only masks, ventilators, protective equipment, medicine, all this is going to Italy, of course. And I give you another example of solidarity. We have regions in Europe that are severely affected. La Croupe was in China. So we have the north of Italy, and we have the northeast of France, and we have the center of Spain. Now I take the example of northeast of France, where we have a huge outbreak, like in Roubaix, very severe. And hospitals, despite new capacities, military hospitals that have been opened, not enough beds. So what did we do? We are relocating patients to other countries.
Oh, yeah.
Can you imagine that?
From Italy to Germany, yeah.
So from France to Germany, yeah. Or France to Luxembourg, or even within France, from one region to another. It is very complex operations. Of course, there were some scandals. You mentioned that the story, it's a very small story, but it had a huge impact, that masks were supposed to go through Germany and Switzerland to Italy were blocked. But this was not a government decision. You mentioned an export ban. There has been no export ban in Europe. So there were lots of stories in the media which were extremely bizarre. So we are also fighting against what we call disinformation, which is maybe even more dangerous than the virus itself, because it puts people in danger by making them believe things that do not exist. Many countries have adopted emergency laws, state of emergency. It's true in France, it's true in Italy, it's true in Spain. So all the countries that are affected have taken emergency measures. These measures restrict basic freedoms. Freedom of movement, of course. That's the first freedom that is affected. Stay at home. Do not move. So people say, for how long? Okay? But none of these emergency measures have attacked freedom of expression.
Expression.
very important to know what doctors are saying. Report from the front line, nurses, doctors. So people today exchange a lot of information. At the same time, and I've mentioned that before, there's a lot of fake information or manipulation going around. So we need to counter that. But this is not an attack against freedom of expression. It is to protect people from dangerous information.
Trump has used the word Chinese virus. So what's your opinion towards that?
It is not a Chinese virus. It is a human virus. There are too many people in government, in general. I'm not pointing fingers. There are too many people who speak or take decisions without knowing. But science is science. So if you look at how the European Union today is watching the crisis and reacting, our national governments are doing, you will see that we all have now an advisory council of doctors. So doctors take the lead. They say to the government what should be done. And then, of course, it is the government responsibility to say yes, no, to balance different things. But the doctors should have the same, including Dr. Li Wenliang, and we appreciate that recognition of the role of his doctors. You know, that immediate outreach of doctors is a stark contrast to petty politician bickering. Do you see doctors blaming someone else? Never. Because doctors know that the blame game is totally self-defeating. Blaming someone else, passing the buck, shuai guo, this is killing lives. And doctors save lives. Just stick to the facts. First epicenter was Hubei. Second epicenter is Europe. Third epicenter will be the US. And probably Africa will be the fourth. So it is a global issue. Everybody today is looking at Europe, the US, but Africa is going to be the next big epicenter of the epidemic. And we need to go quick because you've seen people criticize, you are wasting time, why did you wait? We are not waiting. The European Union has taken the initiative already to send money to Africa, expertise, in order to prevent the spread of a virus on the continent.
So, generally speaking, is there some experience that China and the EU can learn from each other in combating the virus?
The more data China shares with us and with the world, the more we will be in a position to understand this sickness and how do we treat it. China has been on the front line before everybody else. And China today is still in the front line dealing with the aftermath of the crisis. And we should look at what China is doing to try to restart the economy, all the difficulties that the government is confronted with, support to small and medium companies, or as we have seen last week with your president's tour in Zhejiang, to not forget about the green economy, that recovery has to be green. We hope that China will also see that the experience of Europe is useful for itself. How? by the way that the European project show that multilateralism works, that there is no unilateral solution, and that it's not by opposing Chinese to foreigners that things will get better. Foreigners are not the threat. The virus is the threat. So the way that we work across borders right now in Europe should be of interest to China. That the provinces in China should work together. Comprehensive Agreement on Investment, CAI. This negotiation has continued in January, February, March. Next round is in 20th of April. And we are talking with our Chinese counterparts in order that we succeed this 考试, this test. Yeah. 大考,
大考.
This big test. You open, you ask for help. And this is a beautiful thing of the human condition, is that the strong can support the weak. Because if we don't do that, then we will enter extremely dangerous territory in the future. We mentioned that already, the economic shock will be of a magnitude much more severe than the 2008-2009 financial crisis. There will be an economic crisis, probably in the summer. So we need to come together, like it was done at the G20, to say we need to work together to make sure that we have the tools to face this economic shock. One, be compatible with climate change policies, and two, will ensure a better investment environment and a better improved safety net, social security, then we will grow stronger after this crisis, for the next crisis, because there will be a next pandemic.